When I started researching this video, I thought I understood why the Hot 100 chart is so wacky. But I was wrong. It's been a mess for longer than most of us have been alive, and Billboard kinda can't help themselves, so they keep changing it. The truth is, the charts are broken, and we simply shouldn't trust them. You would expect that music charts count sales, and they do, but there are a lot of other factors that muddy the waters. Let's take a look back through history to understand how we got to the chart of today. Back in 1973, Billboard made a large update to its singles chart, adding waiting for radio play, as well as adding sales from wholesalers who supplied jukeboxes around the country. This underweighting of retail sales in favor of what the wholesalers and radio stations were pushing was the first major move in reducing the value of a sale in the singles chart. Then in 1991, Billboard started using data from Nielsen to more accurately report sales. As it turns out, until 91, they were using approximates that retailers self-reported. And guess what? It underreported non-pop music and non-rock music. So, with more accurate sales, hip-hop, R&B, and country music were finally reflected accurately in the charts. 1991 also saw the addition of a recurrence rule, stating that if a song was on the chart for 20 weeks and was charting below number 20, after the 20th week, it would be removed from the charts. This was introduced to kind of rebalance to the Nielsen sales numbers being too accurate, which would have allowed songs to hang on to the chart longer than they traditionally would have. As the final nail in the coffin of the singles chart, in 1998, Billboard started including songs that weren't necessarily available to buy as singles, weighting airplay for album tracks into the top 100. Maybe after all of this, Billboard would have finished meddling, but then came the new millennium, and that brought the promise of digital music. Adding digital sales was easy enough, a sale is a sale after all, but then in 2007, they started factoring in music streams. At first, these came from AOL and Yahoo, showing how much times have changed. Eventually, they picked up Spotify as it launched in the US, and in 2013, they added YouTube to kind of round out the big hitters. In a way, all of this makes sense, but this has fundamentally shifted what the charts do, and to pretend that they're the same or even worth comparing is kind of pure fantasy. New records almost always sold more than legacy records, because most people who wanted to buy an older record already had. That means that our charts fairly accurately reflected what the hot new albums and singles were, by showing consumer demand. This is not at all what the charts do today, because again, streams are not sales. If you buy a record and you play it once, you still bought that record. If you don't buy a record, but you stream it, say, every week for the next year, you're having an impact on that record's chart performance every time you listen to it. Now, don't get me wrong, it's absolutely worth knowing what people are listening to, and it is a worthwhile chart to have, but it's a fundamentally different question. What are people buying versus what are they listening to? You go from 1973 to 91 to today, simply isn't the same chart. The album chart has been more consistent, and for most of its history counted only album sales. But since they started factoring in streams, there have been some weird artifacts that exist in 2021 that wouldn't have existed two decades ago. More legacy acts and albums are hanging on the charts for 5 or 6 or 7 years and likely will never leave. To this end, I took a look at the top 200 chart over the past two decades, and the makeup of it has changed significantly. Back in 2000, 4 of the top 50 albums had been on the chart for more than a year. By 2010, this was 6 of the top 50. And now, in 2021, it's 18 of the top 50. And more than that, 10 of those 18 have been on the charts for more than 2 years. Neither 2000 or 2010 had a single album on the chart for that long. Again, none of this is bad, it's just not the same. Billboard like to pretend this is the same chart, and we still get headlines about record-breaking chart performance, but this isn't our parents' chart, and Billboard would do best not to pretend it is. The multiple recalculations and the formula that now comprise the record charts take a lot of shine off record-breaking performance. We're measuring something, but it's entirely unclear what we're measuring, and what a chart topper did to get there. Did they sell records? Did they get a bunch of streams? Did one single drive an album up the charts, independent of everything else? And then, of course, we have to contend with Billboard openly admitting they change their calculations every single week. I'm not joking, they have guidelines, but they don't have to stick to them. As we wrote in January, when YouTube data was added to the equation, generally speaking, our formula targets a ratio of sales, airplay, and streaming. Of course, that's an overall target for 100 songs each week. In trying to dig up more accurate numbers, I came across a forum called Pulse Music, where members spent several pages going back and forth trying to figure out the calculations for a specific week and appearing to give up. I mean, how can we trust Billboard's chart if there's no way for us to verify it? When I was in university, our lecturer came in one morning with that week's chart stapled to a clipboard. He asked an open question of us, name the artists and the songs on this chart. We got Adele, we got Rihanna, Bruno Mars, I think a couple others, but we quickly ran out of steam and his point was made. This was our music business class, and how did we expect to survive in the industry if we couldn't name the top 10 songs in the country? Since then, I've taken a passing interest in the chart, listening through the Hot 100 occasionally, and every month doing a run through Spotify's global top 50. I find it educational, I find it useful, but researching this video, I'm questioning the Billboard charts all over again. If Billboard can change their formula week by week and just crown whoever they want, then is there even a purpose to their chart? The Spotify chart isn't perfect. It's massively skewed by accessibility and market penetration of Spotify itself, but at least we know what it's counting. As if we weren't already, we'd be best served to ignore Billboard's proclamations entirely. But I'm going to keep listening to the Spotify chart, and I'd love for you to join me. Hopefully once a month, I'd love to do a stream, play through the most popular tunes in the world, and have a chat about them and the artists that made them. Regardless of which corner of music we like to reside in, I think it's worth being aware of the music of the moment. Subscribe if you haven't already to see when those streams go live, and as always, thanks for watching. While I was editing this, I realized I didn't really leave anything for the end screen. But two things. One, I'm really excited to try streaming out. I don't know how it's gonna go, but I'm looking forward to it. And two, next video out is definitely gonna be a hip hop one. The last couple we haven't done that, but I'm excited to get back to it.